Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of your light, of your word, of your presence in our lives. And we pray that you would soften our hearts and our minds, that you would impact our experiences so that we would learn truth from you. In Jesus' name, amen. We have our first lesson this morning from the amazing book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah is a story of perseverance, and it's a story of God's love and faithfulness for his people. The book of Nehemiah starts in Babylon, where some people who have just come from Jerusalem are asked by Nehemiah, how goes it with the folks that are back in Jerusalem? And the answer is, not good. Jerusalem has been devastated. All the walls are down. All the temple is destroyed. All the homes are destroyed. And Nehemiah begins to seek the Lord. It's one of the scriptures in the Bible that teach us to pray, teach us to plead, teach us to cry before the Lord when we need circumstances to change in our lives or in the lives of those we love. God hears our prayers. Now, you may not like this next part, though, because the way God hears and answers Nehemiah's prayer is to say, okay, Nehemiah, you go. God sends Nehemiah to Jerusalem, and he rebuilds the wall, and it is a tough, tough task. But Nehemiah is not just concerned about the wall. When Nehemiah has completed the wall and he begins to address the people, he gives the people what he believes they need most, the teaching of Scripture, which they've gone without now for years. So he gathers them together and he begins to read the Bible to them. I want you to think about that. For those of you who have committed to reading through the Bible in a year, great job. You've committed to about a half an hour of reading a day, and if you do the soaping, maybe another half hour of contemplation, an hour a day. Well, Nehemiah gathered all the people with their children and grandchildren in the sanctuary, not for an hour, but for the entire day as they read and read and read the scripture. And like some of our members, the people wept. Do you think they were weeping because it went too long? The Bible doesn't actually tell us why they were weeping. I wonder if they were tears that were generated simply by knowing that they had been missing something for so long. Sort of a glad, I'm so glad to see you that I'm crying. Ever had those tears when you're reconnected with something or someone you love? That's possible. It's a possible explanation. But I don't think that the response that is given is a response that indicates that they were weeping from joy. I think there's another possibility here, and that's that their lives had gone astray. They had been not only without the word, but without God, without worship. They had been disconnected. And as they heard the word read, I think they were hearing conviction that their lives were no longer being lived correctly, that their thinking was off, that they were wrong. I think they were weeping from guilt and shame. I think they were weeping because they believed the word of God was condemning them. And I believe that some of us, when we hear the word of God read, when we read it ourselves, sometimes also hear the word of God as condemning us. You know, there's a whole movement across Christianity in the United States especially, but even around the world, that says you begin worship with praise, not confession. Confession, pastor, it's a downer. You really don't want to start a service with confession. I mean, when people come, when visitors come, I mean, come on, pastor. Can't we like start with some joy or something? And yet, most of our services start with confession. And I want to tell you that the reason our services start with confession is not for condemnation. The reason our services start with confession is for the love and freedom and mercy of God to wash over us as we begin to worship Him. Because God's word doesn't just bring a word of condemnation. It brings a word of redemption, a word of transformation, a word of hope and joy. It is a time to rejoice. And so Elijah and the leaders of Israel respond to these mournful, tearful people as they're hearing the word of God and says, "Don't mourn or weep on such a day as this. For today is a sacred day before the Lord your God." It's a sacred day before the Lord your God. You are now with God anew. You're now in the family. You're now embraced by the God who created, loved you, and has chosen you. This is not a time to cry and weep. This is a time to rejoice in the presence of God, in the love of God for you. And so while we begin with confession, we celebrate the embrace of God's love and mercy, just like the people of Israel. I don't know if you've ever been in this position in your life where you have a secret from a loved one or from a good friend. And you know that if they knew that secret, it would break their heart. And so you see them again, and you've got the secret well concealed, and they greet you like they always do, with love and joy and embrace, and you're thinking in the back of your mind, if you only knew. If you only knew the truth, you wouldn't love me anymore. There's a sad number of marriages lived in that kind of fear. If you only knew the truth, you wouldn't love me anymore. Too many people come to church and are greeted warmly by our greeters with the thought in the back of their mind, if you only knew the truth, you wouldn't welcome me here, or I wouldn't be welcome because of who I am, because of what I've done. And so we need to speak the truth of God's word to those thoughts that, yes, indeed, they're in the wrong. Yes, indeed, they're guilty, but the response of our amazing God was to give His life to wipe that away so that they could be embraced and loved. As we hear the condemnation of Scripture, what we need to hear is an invitation to reconciliation. That's what God's Word is about. It's about God revealing Himself so that we can continue to live in the joy of that relationship. And so the psalmist writes, "The instructions of the Lord are perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart." It's not just the kids that need occasional correction. Sometimes our own experiences have warped our sense of reality, and we need to be restored by the perfect word of the Lord. Sometimes we just don't get it, and we need our wisdom increased so that we can understand how to live, how to react, how to deal with this immensely fast-changing world in which we live. And by the way, it's not going to help much just to mourn the fact that kids are always looking at their phones. It's just really not going to help you very much to say, isn't it awful? The kids are looking at their phones instead of being outside playing in the snow that we don't have. The real question is, how do we deal with our reality? How can we allow the Word of God in its infinite wisdom to continue to speak truth into our lives so that we follow what God has done? So instead of telling the kids, put that phone down and go outside and play, we invite them to go outside with us and fish or hike or play or even mow the lawn. But they do it at our side. They do it in relationship. And we actually lead them into a relationship that is what we think is the preferred place to looking at their iPhones all the time. You see, the scripture is a gift to show us how to live. And when it convicts us, it's a gift to help us get on the right path again, to help us move back to the center of the road and stop flirting with the edge. We respond to it knowing that it is true and it is reliable and it is good. And when it strikes us as not, the problem is not with the Bible. Problem is with our thinking and our perspective. And so we ask God to use His word to correct us, and we respond to that word, trusting that it will revive our soul. The commandments of the Lord are right, bringing joy to the heart. And sometimes we just need to say to each other what Nehemiah said to the people of Jerusalem. This is not a time to mourn. This is not bad news for you. This is good news. God cares enough to speak the truth. He cares enough to give you a new sense of direction so that you can know the right thing to do. And by the way, the right thing includes love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you. The right thing is, by the way, in case you've forgotten, feed the hungry, care for the sick, look out for the orphan and the widow. Why is that? Because we need each other. Because we're called to live in community. They didn't need to just rebuild the walls in Jerusalem to protect them from attack, which is what the walls were for. They actually also needed some shelter. They needed some food, and they needed community. They needed to learn how to trust one another again. They needed to learn how to care for one another again. And our world needs that desperately. I think we often think about the programs we need to have in the church, and we do, and we think a lot about that. We talk a lot about that, especially in the leadership. But you know what matters most at Desert Hope, besides God Himself? You. It's you. It's your friendships. It's your greeting. It's your concern. It's your love for one another that keeps people coming back. And when people drift away, it's not usually because I've preached a bad sermon, although it happens. It's not usually just because they disagree with me. It's usually at its heart because they don't feel connected. They need to experience community. And a part of what is happening as Nehemiah reads the word again to the people of Israel is that he's reestablishing the center of their community that keeps them connected. And it's why we talk about in our third value, the authority of the Word of God, and our third measure being rooted in the Word of God, because we want that to be the center that holds us together in community. The Word of God is a gift for us to keep us together. And the response of the psalmist is, Lord, may the words of my mouth, may the meditations of my heart be pleasing in your sight. O Lord, my rock, my protector, and my redeemer. Now, I know many of you for years probably sat in churches under pastors who began or ended virtually every sermon with that quote. It's a great quote, but it's not meant just for preachers. It's meant for all of us who follow God. Lord, may the things I say, matter of fact, may the things I even think about be those things that are pleasing to you. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing in your sight. O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. When we talk about being transformed, we're talking about the Word of God transforming not just what we say, not just what we do, not just what the public sees, but the very meditations of our heart. Lord, guide my thinking. Correct my misunderstanding. Help me to see others the way you see them. One of the great insights that came in the light study was a transition that happened in the study of light between the Old Testament and the New Testament. In the Old Testament, when God's light and purity and holiness shine, impurity was destroyed. Matter of fact, God sometimes protected. He put a cloud between himself and the people because he knew if they got too close, if they actually saw the holiness of God, they would die. And while that doesn't change in the New Testament, it does get transformed. Because in the New Testament, when the light shines, we die to ourselves and we die with Christ so that we can live and have eternal life. Because the shining of the light of Christ in our world redeems us. It kills and destroys sin while saving and freeing us to be the children of God. And it calls you and I to treat other people the very same way. That we go to them not to condemn them, but to set them free. Because that's what Jesus did. And we are his ambassadors in the world. Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. It's not always good news. After Jesus said this and continued to teach, and we don't get the teaching, after he said this and he continues to teach, the people are going, wow, he's amazing. Isn't he great? Oh my God, I can't believe this is Joseph's son. This is just great. And then he talks about the fact that God cares for those people, the non-Jewish people, the widow, the leper that they've cast out of their community. And when the Word of God makes clear to them that God cares as much for others as he does for them, they don't rejoice. They try to stone. They try to kill him. They try to throw him off a cliff. And sometimes we too want special treatment. Sometimes we too want our blessings to be our blessings instead of recognizing that we are blessed to be a blessing. And that even when others are not blessing us, we are called to love our enemies and pray for those who persecute us. Even when others aren't being kind to us, maybe they're even betraying us, maybe they're even treating us really badly. At that moment, we remember the scripture that says, and we know God's love for us this way, while we were sinners, Jesus died for us. The Word of God transforms our thinking when it tells us, when people treat you badly, love them more. When people are unkind to you, be kinder. It doesn't say don't speak the truth. It doesn't say hide what they're doing so they don't get in trouble. But it does say love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. The Spirit of the Lord is on me. He has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom to the prisoner, recovery of sight to the blind, release to the oppressed, and proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Proclaim the year that a transformation happened in the people of God, in the people of Israel, the people that you have pushed to the margins, the people that are no longer at the core of you, your community. God wants them back in the heart of his people. The people that don't matter to you matter to God. And the Messiah has come to bless them. By the way, you'll be blessed too if you hang out with them. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the scripture is a part of how God shines his light on our lives. Sometimes what it says doesn't feel good. Sometimes it's like the discipline the children would prefer not to happen. But don't hide. And don't cry. Rather rejoice. That has the power to transform your life. That it has the power to transform this community. And as our light shines, the community in which we live, we are called to be transformed by following Jesus daily, leading others to do the same. Thanks be to God. Amen.